Kazami. I'm the Deputy United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York and the Attorney for the United States in this matter. With me is Bill Sweeney, Assistant Director in Charge of the New York Field Office of the FBI, and James Robnett, who is the Supervisory Agent in Charge of the New York Office of the IRS. Also with me are the prosecutors from the United States Attorney's Office in the Southern District of New York who prosecuted the Cohen matter. I'm going to have a brief statement and will not be taking any questions. Today, as you heard, Michael Cohen pled guilty to 8 felony charges. 5 of those dealt with tax evasion for the years 2012 through 2016, in which he failed to report approximately $4.1 million in reported income. Approximately 2.5 of that money was from interest payments from a personal loan that he failed to report. Approximately $1.3 million of that money was from the operation of his taxi medallion business. Approximately $100,000 of that money was from brokerage commissions, and over $200,000 was from consulting fees. That's over $4.3 million over a 5-year period, which translates into a loss to the United States Treasury of approximately $1.3 million. In addition, in count 6, Mr. Cohen pled guilty to making false statements to a financial institution in connection with an application for a home equity line of credit. In that application, he failed to disclose more than $14 million in debt that he had, and as a result of that concealment, he obtained that $500,000 line of credit, which he would not have been entitled to had he been candid and honest. In addition, Mr. Cohen pled guilty to 2 campaign finance charges, 1 for causing an unlawful corporate contribution, and a 2nd one for personally making an excessive personal contribution, both for the purpose of influencing the 2016 election. In addition, what he did was he worked to pay money to silence 2 women who had information that he believed would be detrimental to the 2016 campaign and to the candidate and the campaign. In addition, Mr. Cohen sought reimbursement for that money by submitting invoices to the candidate's company, which were untrue and false. They indicated that the reimbursement was for services rendered for the year 2017, when in fact those invoices were a sham. He provided no legal services for the year 2017, and it was simply a means to obtain reimbursement for the unlawful campaign contribution. A couple of points I'd like to make. First, these are very serious charges and reflect a pattern of lies and dishonesty over an extended period of time. They are significant in their own rights. They are particularly significant when done by a lawyer who, through training and tradition, understands what it means to be a lawyer, to engage in honest and fair dealing and adherence to the law. Mr. Cohen disregarded that training, disregarded that tradition, and decided that he was above the law, and for that he was going to pay a very, very serious price. With respect to the campaign finance violations, the campaign finance laws are designed to prevent the use of illegal money in elections and to maintain the integrity of those elections. Mr. Cohen made guilty pleas for those campaign violations, and those are core violations. And what he did was, these pleas remind us that it is illegal for corporations to make contributions to candidates, and it is illegal to make contributions in excess of the amount that Congress set for individuals. That is a strong message today, and we will not be, we will not fear of prosecuting additional campaign finance cases. Lastly, and perhaps most importantly, this case is unique in many ways. Just witness the gathering of all of you here today. And in other ways, it's unique as well. But in the really important ways, this case is not unlike many cases that my office, the United States Attorney's Office brings, that the entire Department of Justice brings, and that the law enforcement agencies do as well, including the FBI and the IRS. This case has more in common with all those cases because they all share the same message. And that message is that the rule of law applies, and that for law enforcement, all of whom are gathered here, it is our commitment that we will pursue and vindicate those who choose to break the law, and vindicate the majority of people who live law-abiding lives, who follow honest and fair dealing, and live lives of lawful behavior. The message is that we are here, prosecutors are here, law enforcement is here, the Department of Justice is here, the law enforcement agencies here. We are a nation of laws, and the essence of this case is about is justice, and that is an equal playing field for all persons in the eyes of the law, and that is a lesson that Mr. Cohen learned today, and it is a very harsh one for him. Thank you very much.
Who is the candidate you're talking about?
I'm sorry. One other thing. I'm sorry. I'd also like to introduce. Sorry, my fault. I really want to thank Mr. Sweeney and James Robnett of the FBI and the IRS and the agents who work for them. We do many, many cases with them, and their determination and their fair dealing and their vigor with which they pursue their cases is really inspirational. To the prosecutors in my office, I cannot express the gratitude for the hard work that they did in this case. And that is Assistant United States Attorneys Andrea Griswold and Nick Roos and Rachel Maiman and Tom McKay, as well as Ed Discant, the Deputy Chief of the Public Corruption Unit, and Russell Capone, the Chief of the Public Corruption Unit. For all of these people, I could go on and on about their many virtues and talents. But the one important thing is they all are satisfied with simply being known as public servants, prosecutors, and law enforcement agents who are doing their job. Thank you very much.
Your take on this, what I think Hallie says is crucial for us to understand. Something did change today. There may be people who didn't think there was any legitimacy left to Donald Trump or this presidency, but the fact is, this is different. Today is different than it was 6 hours ago.
I hope so, but here's part of the problem. We still don't have any Republican leadership speaking out saying, you know what, something has changed. The media is saying something has changed, Democrats are saying something has changed, but this lack of separation of powers, the fact that this president has kept his thumb on his entire party and they've fallen in line, the fact that they're still talking about Kavanaugh, we shouldn't be talking about a Supreme Court justice nominee, not when this is going on. So I hope something has changed. I hope something, someone is going to look into the fact that Donald Trump has a 40-year history of leaning on the lines of legality, of lying, of surrounding himself with people who are of ill repute, to say the very least. Anyone in New York knows this. Anyone who can read has seen the documentation. I don't know if chickens are coming home to roost because when he's at his rally, he's already established that the media is a liar.
Right. They're all
that
lying.
Mueller
is, to
is
to
out to get him. So he's already created the scenario where truth isn't truth, right? And he's been doing that since the campaign, that everyone is after him, and it's just up to him.
So
and it's 33% of supporters to sort of, it's us against the world, because everyone's trying to just make up stories that aren't true about us.
So while everything has changed, maybe nothing has changed. Bill Kristol, you and people like you have been trying to take your party back for a while. One might say strategically, you've been handed a gift today. Maybe this is a moment in which you can call up people and say, come on, guys, putting out statements about how this doesn't implicate him in the Russian investigation isn't really the relevant part of this right now. Your president is lying. What do we do about it?
Look, I do think things have changed. I mean, reality has changed in that we now have a guilty plea from the president's personal lawyer, with whom he was very, very close in many ways, and a guilty verdict on the president's campaign manager. Mm-hmm. Those are facts. You can say truth's not truth, he said, she said.
That's right. We accept in this country that verdicts are
And guilty verdicts have a real effect. So I look, is there a hardcore of Trump supporters who will never desert him? Sure, there was with Nixon, too. He had 50% approval among Republicans till the very end. But there are a lot of reluctant Trump supporters, and I think at this point, they get more reluctant in their support, less willing to simply say, saying, well, he's, you know, he tweets a lot, he's kind of a vulgar guy, but we got the Supreme Court justices and we got the tech guys. I do think it begins to change things. And I think their last line of defense, in a way, now of his defenders, you've been reading a couple of those quotes, yep, is, well, it's not Russia. But how do we know it's not Russia? Michael Cohen seems to be cooperating. Mm-hmm. Michael Cohen may well know about the Trump Tower meeting. He may well know if the president knew about the Trump Tower meeting.
And we definitely know that Manafort does.
And Manafort was at that meeting, yeah, if he flips, but he hasn't flipped yet. But,
right,
but Cohen has. And Cohen was in touch with Trump throughout 2016 and 2017. He has contemporaneous knowledge and probably documentary evidence and phone records, mm-hmm, and of Trump's actions in all kinds of aspects of the obstruction side of it, as well as perhaps the collusion side of it. So I don't really buy the argument that this isn't important for the Russia side of the investigation.
That's the point you've been making.
But yes, but you know what's really striking to me is how history has repeated itself here. Back in the Nixon days in the Watergate, Herb Kalmbach, who was Nixon's personal lawyer, was actually his bag man, sort of had the same role as Michael Cohen, was the guy who carried around all the cash, the illegal cash, to spread around. He wound up pleading guilty. And then you also have Manafort being convicted today, who was Trump's campaign manager. And you had John Mitchell, who was Nixon's campaign manager, who had been convicted. So what I'm really struck by is just how history has repeated itself, mm-hmm, today with both a president's personal lawyer and his campaign manager.
Natasha Bertrand, let's just play this out just a little bit more. If there's somewhere between 33% and 40% of Americans who continue to support Donald Trump, as the evidence piles on, that gets harder to do. But there are a lot of people that Bill was just talking about, Republicans who are not interested in supporting Democratic candidates. They're not interested in upending their party. They would like their party back. How does this play out politically? Forget, we've talked a lot about the legal side, but how does this play out politically for people who are not Democrats, who are reluctant supporters of Donald Trump, who can't get away from this evidence anymore?
Well, it's remarkable how the narrative has really been shifting. I mean, it used to be, of course, that there was no communication at all between the campaign and Russia. That was Paul Manafort's line throughout the campaign. Then it was, well, there may have been a few contacts, but they were really, you know, inconsequential. And now we're seeing this new kind of talking point emerge, which is people on the right are saying, well, it would have been kind of a dereliction of duty for the campaign not to have taken these meetings with the Russians and to see what kind of dirt that they had on Clinton. So politically, I think that even if a ton of evidence came out that definitively said that the campaign conspired with Russia to undermine the election and to coordinate with the Russians to get this dirt on Clinton, and in that way they promised, you know, for example, sanctions relief, or they promised to upend the entire international order that we've, you know, adhered, mm-hmm, to for decades, then I think that, you know, people on the other side of the aisle would say, on the Republican side would say, well, you know, this was standard. This was just opposition research. It seems like that argument has really started to take hold in right-wing circles.
I mean, I think they made that argument, Natasha, but I don't think it will really take hold enough. I think at that point you start to lose enough House members, enough senators, enough party leaders that impeachment becomes a real possibility. Mm-hmm. If there is real collusion,
yeah,
or if there is real collusion, not Trump vaguely knew about some meeting, and
Christina,
if there's real collusion on the WikiLeaks,
you think it changes things?
You're
totally
more optimistic than I. You know, maybe because for the past 2 years we've witnessed a race baiting president who's you know, caucus with white supremacists to the silence of his entire party. So I don't know why all of a sudden they would wake up and say, you know what, this is a bridge too far.
Well, they may
How
not
many
say
bridges
that, but
do we need?
Look, I'm not defending them, but I'm just not saying, as a practical matter, the Democrats are likely to win the House of Representatives in November. Mm-hmm. If they win the House,
if Russia doesn't collude and actually affect our elections. That's a possibility.
It is, but
we
looks
haven't
for
addressed
now,
2016 yet.
I agree with that. Also, they should have done more, but it looks for now that the Democrats will win the House. If they do, and if there's real evidence on either the collusion or the obstruction, mm-hmm, side, and maybe incidentally, I'm not so sure that the cooperation being involved is in the just in the payoff isn't enough. That's a real crime. It's, mm-hmm, a federal crime. Yeah. If you're the House of Representatives, what do you say? Well, we're just not even going to look into this. They have to at least have hearings.
But that's sort of crime.
But these are the same people who are trying to push through Kavanaugh.
Democrats, I mean, look, obviously Republicans hold the House, that'll be a different story. But I think today's events have made it much less likely that Republicans hold the House. And I think once you get into real, we saw this with Clinton, once you get into real impeachment hearings and real looking at the evidence and real, it's a little harder for people to say, well, look, there's evidence that it's a crime. Not that he's a distasteful, unpleasant,
Natasha?
Even bigoted guy. I think it changes.
I just want to make one final point, which is I think that Trump, if he did conspire with the Russians, and all evidence points to, you know, him doing that, then he did it in a way that Vladimir Putin would do it, which is to preserve plausible deniability by farming out the most significant aspects of such a conspiracy to people like Michael Cohen, to people like Paul Manafort, to people like George Papadopoulos, just like Vladimir Putin farmed it out to hackers that perhaps were not directly associated with the Russian government, to preserve that kind of plausible deniability. So if we take that to be true, and if people like Michael Cohen are found to, for example, have traveled to Prague to pay off these hackers, if Trump himself didn't do it, then I can definitely foresee Republicans saying, well, the president himself may not have authorized this.
Well,
how do we know?
Unless Michael Cohen testifies that he did tell the president about it, or unless there's contemporaneous evidence that he did. This is why
Cohen
has always
been... To which Donald Trump could respond,
been,
well, he was given a plea deal to maybe reduce his prison sentence.
I mean, he surrounds himself.
Well, they can say whatever they want, but I do think it's a... I mean, look, I'm not defending the Republicans. I'm not saying they...
But
there is a huge amount of rationalization that's possible.
You're awfully optimistic.
I just think the guilty plea and the guilty verdict make a big difference, I think.
And we don't know what all those tapes are. Michael Cohen has got a whole series of tapes. You know, what is on those tapes?
We got another Omarosa tape coming up in about 2.5 minutes, actually. Right. I can't imagine what's on that. All right, Christina, to you, I hear you. When's the bridge that's a bridge too far going to show up, right? To a lot of people, I think maybe today might have been it, but a lot of people,
these are the same
the
people
E-tape
who were waiting for the N-word 3 days ago, right?
Yeah.
I mean, so we know that Donald Trump has surrounded himself and possibly given instructions to Michael Cohen, someone who he has trusted for a very long time. Mm-hmm. We know that Donald Trump is engaged in this behavior in Atlantic City, in Queens, in all over, you know, the five boroughs for decades. This is just, you know, a con that's gone a little too far, and now the federal government is involved. But I don't see, and this is, I've been ringing the alarm on the show for months now, the separation of powers is not working because the Republican Party has not stood up to this president, not once. So even if there is a guilty verdict from Manafort, even though Cohen has turned himself in, 8 counts here, 8 counts there, I still think that they have been so willing to move the goalpost every single time with this president, no matter what he says, no matter what he does. Right? The fact that he was even sworn in as president after the Access Hollywood tape let me know for a fact that the Republican Party is actually not working on behalf of the American people. They are working on behalf of Donald Trump. And he's been able to bully them into their silence. And I don't think that today changes much, unfortunately. I'm sure we'll hear what he has to say about this at his rally. But Fox News is talking about, you know, a girl in Iowa and not this, right? And tomorrow morning, we know he'll wake up and tweet and sort of, you know, besmirch the reputation of Michael Cohen and all the people around him and really go back to Mueller. And this is obviously going to boil down to Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama.
The bigger threat is that he is the pardon power, which I think is, I think someone said,
he's
the wild card.
Might be floating that in his compliments.
No, that couldn't be.